Hi, I'm Sean Romo, Senior Staff Archaeologist with the Jamestown Rediscovery Foundation, and I'm here today with Director of Archaeology, David Gibbons. Now, we're out here at historic Jamestown, practicing social distancing. You can see that we're about 6 feet away. And we're going to talk to you today a little bit about radiocarbon dating as part of our ongoing series, Dig Deeper at Jamestown. Explain a little bit of the science behind radiocarbon dating.
Well, one of the things that archaeologists love to do is to date the deposits they're working on, right? Date a skeleton, date a specific layer. And one of the ways that we can do that with chemistry or science in chemistry is to look at the ratio of carbon-12 and carbon-14 that's sequestered in a material. Now, carbon-14 and carbon-12 are naturally in our environment. They're formed in the upper atmosphere when a nitrogen molecule is bombarded by particles from the sun, and that forms radioactive carbon-14 and stable isotope carbon-12. Now, the difference between the two is that carbon-12 is very stable, of course, and decays at a very slow rate, and carbon-14, being radioactive, is unstable and decays with a half-life of 5,730 years. Now, that allows the archaeologists, if you send a sample out to a lab, to get a date back in which the carbon-12 and the carbon-14 are decaying and giving you a ratio where a clock starts and then begins to decay over time. So in the lab, they can read that and then give you a rough estimate of the date.
So radiocarbon dating is another tool in the archaeologist's arsenal for figuring out when a feature or a deposit dates to, or even an artifact, since we can date directly human bone, charcoal fragments, oyster shells, and other organic things. Now, today, we actually went out and sampled charcoal from an archaeological feature that we have recently discovered so that we could send it out to get radiocarbon dated. And we do the sampling in a very specific way, because we don't want to contaminate the charcoal sample or the bone or whatever else we're pulling from a feature. So, first thing we do, wear gloves. That way, none of the oils or other material on your skin can get onto the artifact and potentially deposit new carbon. Then, we clean off our tools. So, we'll use a trowel, spray it off with distilled water, and then wipe it off with a neutral wipe, like a non-bleached paper towel. That'll make sure that there's nothing adhering to our tools that might get into the sample. The next thing we do is we scrape away a little bit of the overlying soil so we can make sure that our sample has not been exposed to the air or the environment to get new carbon deposited. We want to make sure it is just what was there when the sample went into the ground in the first place. So then we'll dig out that little piece of charcoal or animal bone or what have you, and we'll put it into a piece of tin foil, seal it up really tightly, and then put it into a plastic bag. Once that is labeled, we'll send it on down to our friends Data Analytic in Florida, and they'll test that sample for us, and then get back to us very quickly.
Now, the reason that we don't carbon date everything that we come across is that as you move forward in time, it gets less accurate. And the reason is because that carbon ratio between 12 and 14 is less and less. And so often here at Jamestown, because of the stratigraphy, in other words, the layers of history cake that are out here are so tightly dated for us in comparison to the historic documents that we don't often need carbon dating to give us plus or minus, say, 20 years, which is often the case with carbon dating. As you go back in time, thousands of years, 20 years isn't going to make that much of a difference. But here at James Fort, if I want to know that this house is 1619 or this skeleton was buried in 1627, that makes a big deal. And I already know within a few years of what I'm looking at. So this is a very unique case in which we have a carbon-rich feature that we'd like to just pin down to at least within a 30-year time period.
Yeah, one of the things we really want to see with this is, does it go with a European household, or a colonial household, Or is it far older? Does it date to an earlier Native American occupation that could have been before the colonists arrived at Jamestown? And radiocarbon dating will tell us that.
Now, with this segment of Dig Deeper, I think the theme for that we wanted to get out, or for this segment, is that archaeology is science. And we use the biggest tools to get the job done right. And sometimes it's sending things off to a lab, and sometimes it is out shoveling in the hot sun. But it takes a large range of activities, labs and things like that, a big sort of multinational, multi-international team, as it were, to solve our mysteries. And although today, again, we're practicing social distancing and the coronavirus has shut us down, we can do things like what we did today, sample carbon. You have to wear a mask and gloves and things like that, and send it off to a lab, and it doesn't really affect our process of archaeology out here. So we'll continue to make these videos for you guys, letting us know what we're up to, and we appreciate your support.
Thanks for watching.